Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my
There's a reason today I might be speaking a little slower and a little less polished. For a number of years, about 10 years, I think every year except my first year, this time of year I do what I call the state of the church message. Every year I wonder why in the world did I start that tradition. It is far and away, the most difficult message to put together of any all year long. It's just a tough message. But I invite you to hear just not even an entire verse, but to hear just part of a verse. Matthew 10, verse 8, simply says, "Freely you have received, freely give." Freely you have received, freely give. Will you pray with me? So, O Christ, pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. For your name we pray. Amen. 2 weeks ago, yesterday, I had a really special privilege, a really unique spiritual experience. I, along with over 1,000 other people, gathered in the gym at Millbrook High School to celebrate the life of Sheila Brown's brother. He was called affectionately Woo Wooten. He, for years, worked in youth ministry in his local church. He was a high school coach. He was a driving instructor. It was very evident very quickly he was one who had a powerful influence leading others to the good news of Jesus Christ, as there were hundreds of young people gathered in that gym who gave testimony to the difference that he had made in their life. I couldn't hear a lot of what went on because of my hearing and because it was in a high school gym and the sound system being what it was. But at a certain point, one of the speakers talked about in the old days when they were all back in youth group. And he mentioned a song, Pass It On. Yeah, if you were, as I was, in the youth group in the late 60s, early 70s, everybody knew the song, Pass It On. That was just, everybody knew it. It was the song that you sang. You didn't sing anything else. When that was mentioned, I found myself just going down memory lane, I guess. And found myself those words, if it only takes a spark to keep a fire going, and soon all those around can warm up in its glowing. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread his love to everyone. You want to pass it on. You know, the words are still so deeply embedded. And I found myself getting actually quite emotional because I started thinking about back my own youth group, how my parents took me to church every Sunday and Wednesday night, how my favorite time of the week was youth group time, how I was so shaped by the church. And then through all the years, and now for 38 years as a pastor, the love of the church, the difference the church makes, I simply am not, could not be anything hardly at all except for the church. And I say all that because here I am this morning. My assignment is to talk about the state of the church. How do I talk objectively about that which means everything in my life? How do I talk objectively about that which is oftentimes the first thing I think of when I wake up in the morning, and the last thing I pray about when I go to bed at night? And the real challenge, even more than that, is how do I be sure that when you leave here this morning, one thing you know for sure, I love Wake Forest Baptist Church. I'm so lucky and blessed. I have minister friends everywhere who would give anything to be in a church like this church is. And yet to be faithful to say, here's where we are, and this is the state of the church. What are some of the opportunities yet at the same time before us? But if you want to talk about the state of the church, we could talk about the state of the church in America. And the news is not good. The state of the church in America is one of a rapidly declining enterprise. Whatever study you want to, statistic you want to use, anywhere from 4,000 to 7,000 churches are closing their doors every year now in America. The most rapidly growing religious group in America today is what's called the nuns, not Catholic sisters, but N-O-N-E-S, who when asked, what is your religious preference? They will say none. And that's the fastest growing group in America. Here we are in the Triangle, one of the fastest growing areas, certainly in this state, if not this country. And yet, if you were to look at the statistics of the Raleigh Baptist Association, over 100 churches in this fast growing area, what you will see is a rapidly declining membership right here in the Triangle. All three of my previous churches now have less than half the attendance of what they had when I was their pastor. And on I could go. It's what you need to realize, more than I think some do sometimes, we are fighting for the life of this church 365 days a year. To just somehow think we're on cruise control around here and that everything just automatically comes together, you don't have a clue. The headwinds that we face in this church every single day in this community. And so what of our church? What would you say? How blessed we truly are. what opportunities now can be ours. Every day, I don't think there's ever a day I don't see evidence of God in the people that I'm looking at right now. If you wanted to go the route of conventional metrics, you could say, well, we had over 70 people join our church this past year. Yes, we came right at 99.6% of a reduced budget. Let's be honest about that, but the giving was wonderful. We have what I consider to be a world-class ministerial team that have the privilege of serving alongside a world-class group of people that you all represent. You know, I say sometimes, and people always like this when I say it, and I like to say it, we really are becoming more and more the alternative church in this community. We are traditional in worship. We are unique in so many ways in what we do with missions. We hold fast to some traditions. We're not like the next show coming down the street. We've been around the block. We know what we're doing here. We're the alternative church in so many good and wonderful ways. Let me just quickly, a couple of reminders of some celebrations, just not even remotely the whole list, but some things, even just this past year, you know, in missions, 77 people, more than ever, went on a mission trip to South Carolina this summer. We had others go to Uganda. We have others going to Bahamas, others going to New York City. And every single week in this backyard that is ours, we have people serving every week hot dogs in the Taylor Park. Every month, interfaith food shuttle with hundreds of people. 14,000 pounds of produce in the community garden over the past 3 years. On and on I could go. This is the best thing about, of all the best things about our church, is that we are on mission every single week. I celebrate the music of this church, the choir. Yeah, Christmas season, we were just, for me, my soul was continually filled by the music of this church that has always been a strength of it. Senior adult ministry has taken several notches up these days. Not only do we now have trips that senior adults enjoy every single month, but now we have this connections ministry, which I love, where people in our church are reaching out and being sure to keep connected to those who are homebound in our fellowship. I celebrate the growth in our youth group. You know, they come to early worship. You know, there's just a crowd of youth now. There's 30-some, Adam was telling me this morning between services, that he put all the special trips together. You probably have close to 90 youth now that are participating in our youth ministry in one way or another. One of the real celebrations for me is that no longer is this location the place where one church meets, but now we are a place where two churches meet. Now that the Korean church is meeting in our new building. Every single week now, they are reaching out to people beyond the walls that we simply would not have the opportunity to connect with. And so now we are multiplying the ministries of this church, and that's wonderful. This past year, we had two major celebrations, you might say. One was that we so smoothly transitioned into dual Sunday school and worship. I can't tell you enough. That was a sign of health for me about this church as much as anything I've ever seen. Those kind of things can cause eruptions and disturbances in churches. And when we finally did it, I even said that first Sunday, well, that wasn't so bad, because we were all expecting that completely new schedule. And then at the same time that we went over the goal of our Over and Beyond the Walls campaign. Let me say one word about, a little bit about that giving. I every bit as much celebrate that now we also have the giving to renovate our children's wing this coming year. We're looking forward to that top floor. We got the youth, we got the new building, but we want to get our children more excited about the space that is theirs. And the money now has come in, and we're looking forward to that. But you know what I really want? What I really, really want is not just a renovation of the children's wing, but a revival of our children's ministry. And I expect that we're going to give more attention to that, because that's simply so close to my heart. It's so much where I see these children down here, but then I see those who are not. This is the foundation that we've got to build, and this is where we need to give our attention. And let me just say one last thing about celebrations. This past year, more than any of my 11 years here, unbelievably so, we have so many health concerns. So many people with cancer, and just sometimes it seemed like every other week. But again and again, yesterday we buried one of our very finest. I continue to see a remarkable love, and just a divine sense of care, this sense of family that we talk about so much. And I tell you, I sit back and I marvel. I truly marvel when I see how much love is just continually lived out in the life of this church. Yeah, if I were living, and I am barely some days, but if I'm living, this is where I would want to be if I had a health issue. If I had any crisis in my life, and I've had them since, never know when I'm going to get emotional. I've had crisis in my 11 years, and I was really glad that I came through it because of this church. And I'm really glad when some of you I've seen came through because you had a church family. This can't be quantified, it can't be graphed, it can't be charted, but it's so powerful. It's something we care so much about. So yeah, I love this church. So blessed. But where do we go from here? Here we go. You know, I'm gonna get there. Where do we go from here? Yeah, we've given very essential, necessary energy, a lot of energy these past few years to the new building, to the campaign, to dual Sunday school and worship. Hear me again, all those really were necessary. They accomplished, you see, a critical purpose. They did what I would say, they made the scaffolding that now has laid the foundation so that we can now move forward to do the mission and ministry that God wants for this church. But we couldn't do all that we want to do beyond the walls if we had not had a new building. And when we pay off the building, we're removing the financial barrier so we can give our money to them ministry kind of things. And these can we dual Sunday school and worship. Remember the 11 o'clock crowd, we couldn't find room for people. We had to go to dual worship. And you all did all those things, and I praise you for it. You did what has to be done to move us to the next level. And so it's not just about programs and money and all that. It's about being participants in what God is trying to accomplish here in this church. So this morning, I want to speak to three, I had in my text, challenges, and then I scratched it out and said, it's really opportunities. I wish we could get these three really better. There are three things that need to be improved on. I think they're the three most important things. Number one is what I call, and trust me, there's more frustration on this than any other issue in our church for me. And I think I can speak pretty well for the other ministers. It's what we call the frequency of attendance issue. It's epidemic, not unique at all to our church. I've talked to the pastors of Trinity Baptist, of Hayes Martin Baptist, two other very healthy, best churches down in Raleigh. They're all saying we're experiencing the same thing, frequency of attendance issue. What is that? It simply has to do with the increasingly common experience that those who call themselves followers of Christ and those who are consider themselves to be regular church attenders are increasingly more and more coming maybe once, twice at most, sometimes over an entire month span. So last week or week before last, I thought I was going to preach this last week, I did something I wanted to do for years, something I really had speculated about and found to be even more true than I was guessing. Yeah, we average and have for a couple of years now hit a ceiling of worship attendance. two services combined of about 450. My guess, looking out, I know pretty well, I can almost tell you what the numbers are. Between this service and the next, we've hit this ceiling of about 450 people, youth, adults, children. For all that, 70 people have joined, and that's a pretty normal year for us. We still are not seeing an increase in attendance. Why is that? Because the frequency of attendance issue. So I went through the entire roster back a few weeks ago, literally counted everybody that I was positive that I had eyeballed at one time or another during the month of November and December. So we're averaging 450 people. Guess how many people I've seen, literally seen, over a two-month period? 600. I said for years, I bet it's around 700, which is awful. I counted them up conservatively. It was 742 people that I've seen here at one time or another, November or December. Now think about what that means. Think about what it means this morning. That there are 300 people who probably, if you were to ask them, would consider themselves good church folks who are somewhere else than here this morning. 300 people. We're not talking about people we haven't seen in 20 years. We're talking about people we've seen. What does that mean for discipleship? You know, we are trying to build disciples around here, but it's hard to do it with part-timers. What does it mean for discipleship? What does it also mean for connectedness? We talk about how close we are and the care we give, but if you're hardly here or only here sporadically, you can't possibly be as connected as if you are here on a regular basis. And so it's a spiritual issue. It's a church health issue. It's an issue that continually makes it hard for us to do ministry. And again, I will keep coming back, especially it's heart breaks my heart to see parents of young children that are doing so many other options, and we hardly get a chance to grow them into the best news of all, the grace and love of Jesus Christ. So my question, what is the spark? What is the spark? Oh, I tell you, if I knew the answer to that, I'd probably go on the lecture circuit. But what is the spark that could get people to remember that the way God designed us is that we are designed to worship? We are spiritual beings. He meant for us to remember the Lord's Day and keep it holy, to rest from all those other 90-mile-an-hour days that all of us have. It's just, for so many of us, a part-time deal. What is the spark that could change that? I wish I knew. Second thing I want to talk about is generosity. I've already mentioned my praise. You know, on top of the giving, there's always been these campaigns. We're getting close to the end, folks. But in 5 years' time, to be able to pay off a $3.7 million debt on the new building and youth center is an incredible achievement to meet the budget last year. But let me let you in on something. The budget that's being requested for this previous year, for this existing year, 2017, calls for an increase of over $100,000. There's a part of me that says that ain't going to happen. There's another part of me, quite frankly, said that should be probably the easiest thing we could do around here. With the number of people multiplied by just a little bit of increase with everybody, that's achievable and then some. But will it happen? If we just step up, that you look at that chart you just saw earlier, everybody would go a little further. But please, and always, and this is the hard thing for ministers. Just let you know how it is in pastor world. We really don't like to talk about money. We really don't. Some people think we talk about money all the time, and then, you know, I do it about twice a year, and I do it all the time. But nevertheless, this is not about budget. This is about fulfilling God's dream for our church. It's not what God wants from you. It's what God wants for you. To have that kind of trust, to know the joy of generosity. We're trying to develop disciples around here. That's the goal. And part of being a disciple is being faithful and trusting God for all things, including but not limited to our finances. One common thread, something some of you have been around a while have heard me say, always, and this is such a compliment, to whom much is given, much is required. I just think this is a five-talent church. I think we have been given uniquely personalities, spiritual gifts, resources, location, facilities, on and on and on. And so are we being faithful with all that we have been given? You see, we are blessed for a reason. We are blessed in order to be a blessing, to be conduits, to be vessels of God's desires and dreams. And I don't think there's a church in Wake Forest that has the opportunity to transform in ways that are healthy and theologically sound as does Wake Forest Baptist. So we sing the hymn just now, because I have been given much, I too must give. Well, of course, that's just the rhythm of life. The best reason for giving is always a heart of gratitude that longs to build up his work, to support his church, and to best of all discover the difference of living a life with an open hand and an open heart. In 2 weeks, we will have Consecration Sunday. We'll be asked, what do we want to do in terms of being faithful to God's dream? And I just hope you'll step it up a little bit. And just not because it's about a budget, but because it's about God's dream for our church. And so I asked the question, what is the spark? You saw that step up chart. You know we could be doing better around here. What is the spark that would take us to the next step? I wish I knew the answer. Again, I would go on the lecture circuit if I did. Last of all, the spirit of invitation. I really do believe most of you love this church. In fact, I really believe all of you do. I better should clarify that. Sure, we love some things better than others, but we love this church. We know the difference it's made in our life. I was talking to a lady this week, I could share this story every single week, who just talked about how much this church meant to her and how it carried her through a difficult time. And I look around the stories in my story, we so many of us have been sharing that same kind of story through the years. And yet, for all the love, it's surprising to me that it doesn't seem to ever quite completely translate into inviting others and telling others the good news of the difference it makes to be a part of Wake Forest Baptist Church. Trust me, there are some wonderful exceptions, and I'm not unaware of those. But for so many and for so often, I have said, this is not an inviting church. It is a welcoming church. People come into this church, they are just bowled over by the friendliness and the welcoming. But not many of them are being invited. It's just because we're in a good location, we have a decent website, and people want to check us out. And there are a number of guests here today. We're really glad that you're here. I wonder if anybody invited you or you just showed up, whatever the reason, come back. We love you being here. But let me just cite some numbers again. All the studies, all the surveys, anywhere from 55 to 60% of people, unchurched people, will come to church if they are invited by a family member. About 50 to 55% will come if they're invited by a friend or just any kind of relationship. So there you are, over half the people who are unchurched in our community, over half of them would probably come if they were invited by somebody that you have a relationship, that they have a relationship with you. And so think about what that can mean. It's not about this, we want to be a big church with big numbers. It's about we want to have people in our community in this unique time in the life of Wake Forest community where more people are coming in than ever before, certainly in my time. And we're in a country now that is increasingly anxious about what is happening in our government and in the coming days. We have the good news of Jesus Christ that makes all the difference that people need in such times. If I only knew the spark that could get you to be inviting others, I would just love to know how I could light that fire. You see, it only takes a spark. I really do believe that. The song is theologically appropriate. It only takes a spark. See how little, just a little more attendance, a little more generosity, a little more invitation would dramatically have an impact on the life of this church. Just a spark. But what is that spark? You always think the little illustration kind of captures me. You multiply 3 times 3 times 3 times 3, you get 243. You just take it up one step, 4 times 4 times 4 times 4. What do you think it'd be, 600, 700 maybe? It goes from 243 to 1,024, just taking up one little step. And I just say that because what is the little step that sometimes we could take as a church that would just have dramatic impact, I think. And the beauty of it is it would bring joy. It would bring greater joy than we've ever known to be participants in that kind of thing. Freely you have received. Freely you have received. Freely may we give, and I don't mean just money. Let us give of our best selves, our best faith, our best invitations, our best hearts. It only takes a spark to get a fire going. So what is that spark? I am that spark. And so are every single one of you. We all are the sparks that together can ignite a fire, the fire of God's Spirit that wants to set a church uniquely positioned to be on fire for this community and show people the face of Christ in ways that they are longing to know. It only takes a spark to get a fire going. I want to be that spark. Will you join with me these days?
How it is with God's love. I wish for you, my friend, this happiness that I found. You can depend on him. It matters not where you're bound. I'll shout it from
So let your light so shine that all may see your good works and give glory to the Father who is in heaven. You have permission to extinguish your candle, but you do not have permission to extinguish its spirit and go forth and be the light. I want to say a word of welcome to guests that are with us. We celebrate that you've added to our company. We hope you'll want to be a part of it in the future. I highly recommend this church. We have a guest reception room over to the side. We'd love for you to stop by just so we can share you information or get to know you better. Janice Ishikawa from our outreach team would be love to meet with you over there. I hope you'll stay for the church conference, snack lunch down in the fellowship hall immediately following the benediction. Let us pray and respond with the Gloria Patri. Christ before you, Christ behind you, Christ within you, grace upon grace, mercy upon mercy, love all love, Jesus Christ our Lord, thanks be to God.